Hi, good to see you again. Say, I wonder, when you're on summer vacation, do you go camping with your family? Do you set up a tent in the Black Hills? Or maybe take a trailer out to the Owyhee Dam and watch Dad while he does a little fishing? The first people to live in South Dakota lived in tents, something like this, and they called them teepees. Today, we'll learn about the inside of a teepee and we'll discover the Sioux lifestyle. We'll learn that each Sioux tribe had its own rules, responsibilities, and rewards. When I say different, what I mean is, do all Chinese children look alike to you? How about all African children? Do all African children look alike? And what about Americans? Do all American children look alike? Well, maybe the answer depends on whether or not you're African, Chinese, or American. We all like to think we're a little bit different. When I say the word Indian, what picture comes into your mind? Do all Indians look alike? If you drew a picture, would it look like this? The Dakota and Lakota Indians, often called the Sioux, are the ones many people picture. They were very powerful people who became well known in the United States. They were self-reliant and determined not to be conquered by any other tribe or nation. Anthropologists, scientists interested in studying people, tell us the Sioux Nation was made up of people who lived near the seacoast in North Carolina about 500 years ago. When white people came to the eastern coast of North America, the Sioux moved northward and westward. They lived in villages along the Ohio River that forms the southern boundary of Ohio and Indiana. Gradually, the Sioux were pushed farther westward. They lived in the state of Minnesota more than 300 years ago. Missionaries and traders who went up the St. Lawrence River and across the Great Lakes to the west met some of the Hidatsa, Arikara, and Mandan clans who were in Minnesota before the Sioux arrived. Since many of the Indian tribes had been nomads or hunters, it's not easy to prove exactly where they had been. But being forced westward became a way of life for most of the Indian people as more and more non-Indians came from Europe. The Chippewa Indians, moving across Canada and through Wisconsin, drove the Sioux into Minnesota. As the Sioux continued moving westward, the Cheyenne were forced to move into North and South Dakota. The Cheyennes later joined the Mandan and moved as far west as the Black Hills and eastern Wyoming. Three major tribes made up the Sioux Nation: Teton, Santee, and Yankton. The Santee were also called the Sioux of the East. The Teton and Yankton were known as the Sioux of the West. Most of the people lived by gathering wild rice in Minnesota, by selecting wild plants and berries, and by hunting on the prairie lands of what is now North and South Dakota. As the tribes moved about, they became scattered. The Yanktons wandered southward and finally made their homes along the James River and the southern border of South Dakota. The Santee remained in Minnesota. The Tetons moved as far west as the Bitterroot Mountains of Wyoming. How serious the Dakota were about keeping track of their past is noted in a record called a winter count. They had no written language then, so the Sioux kept track of events with pictures. The pictures would start in the center of an elk or a deer hide or a buffalo hide and spiral out towards the end. Each picture represented a different event, and each year was titled by an important event from that time. Herman Red Elk, a contemporary Sioux artist, offers this interpretation of a modern winter count.
Every year, the winter count was always the chief's way of keeping a record of his tribe. The winter count consists of drawing on a buffalo hide after it is cured and tanned. The artist uses bone brushes and earth colors, and he boils the buffalo hoofs to make glue, and he keeps his glue warm and thin it with water, and puts the pictographs on the buffalo skin with the bone brushes. The picture for the year is selected by the tribal chief and its counselors. They usually think of the one most important happening for that year. The winter count is also a count of the tribe's death. The winter count usually starts in the middle of their buffer robe and goes counterclockwise and goes to the left and up and over to the right. They count different things like horse stealing, how many horses they stole from the enemy.
One of the important matters in Dakota life was the confidence and faith the people had in their nation and tribe. Like some of today's modern families, aunts, uncles, and cousins live together. The Dakota extended family, called the Tayoshpe, was very close, especially in everyday living conditions. And because of that, cooperation required some set rules, although each Tayoshpe was independent and made its own rules and laws. Family life was centered around the teepee, and few non-Indians understand its importance. The original teepees were made of buffalo hide. Our example here at the W.H. Over Museum in Vermilion is made of canvas. The Sioux teepee was ideal for the nomadic life of the people who followed the buffalo. But it was also ideal for permanent camp life. The 20-foot-wide teepee was warm in the winter and cool in the summer. Its 20-foot poles were easy to pitch. Due to its shape, the teepee could withstand terrific winds and driving rains. Comfort could be found around the open fire in the center of the teepee. To let out the smoke, Indians tilted the cone-shaped teepee and placed the vent, an opening to let out the smoke, on the front, which was the longer side of the teepee. Pole placement in the rear made it possible to keep the teepee smoke-free, yet warm and dry. Definite rules were made for a family living in a teepee. An open door meant that friends could come right in. A closed door meant that a guest must call out and wait for an invitation to enter. Sticks crossed over the door indicated the owner was either away or did not want company. Closed smoke flaps and a tied-down door were signs that the family was away and the teepee was safe from all intruders. Men sat on the north side of the teepee and women on the south. A guest always sat on the host's left, or the heart side. Upon entering the teepee, the men moved to the right and women moved to the left. If one walked between a seated person and the fire, he asked for pardon. A younger person would say, "Excuse me, my father," or "Excuse me, my grandfather." At feasts, men were served first. Guests were served before the host. If guests did not eat everything placed before them, they could invite others to share, or the guests could carry the food home with them. To refuse to eat what was offered was to offend the host. Each person brought his own eating utensils. Women did not sit cross-legged as men did. Women folded their legs to one side or sat on their knees in order to take care of the fire or the cooking. Children stayed near the door and could easily run and play outside. They were never allowed to run inside the teepee. Leadership came from the older men, called a council of wisdom, where they were elected. A chief was then chosen from the council members. Sometimes two chiefs were chosen. Council meetings were gathering times for the wise, the brave, and the just. No fine clothes were worn because everyone was equal. Everyone was welcome at the meetings. Sometimes the greatest of men had the least to say, and no chief tried to force his thinking upon others. Like people everywhere, the Sioux society had helpers that kept life systematic yet pleasant. Wise men were highly honored. They offered blessings and taught that life was happier when everyone learned to give rather than receive. Statesmen understood the rights and duties of people and helped everyone understand nature and the natural goodness of life. Healers used water, air, sunlight, and plants in curing ills. Storytellers shared stories, told jokes, and performed pantomimes. Newswalkers kept the people informed about all the things that affected their lives, births, deaths, and so on. Holy men and women performed religious ceremonies and were said to have special powers. Individuals belonged to special groups called lodges. The oldest is called the Fox Lodge. And they are the helpers. If anyone is in need of help, it is the Fox Lodge that will be there. Women could belong to a lodge of their own if one of their male relatives had a fine war record or had lost his life in battle. In costumes, half red and half blue, they danced to honor their heroes. A dancer might carry a piece of war equipment to honor her relative. The ways the Sioux use their leisure time is not very different from those of all of us. The children imitated older people's activities and played games of their own. Boys and girls learned a variety of skills when they began to grow up. Men and women enjoyed lodges, singing, dancing, and celebrations. Quietly then, the Sioux had time to be alone, time to pray, and time to meditate. They searched for the good life in spite of their pride in war. And like people everywhere, they struggled with themselves to be less selfish and more thoughtful of other people. It would be hard to find a people more generous than the Sioux, and nowhere is that more evident than in the Sioux family. And next time we get together, we'll discover what made the Sioux family special.